Thank you for this opportunity, and thank you for the kind words, Mr. Santosh Katsura, sir. And so today's topic, that is a digital forensics and trends. Coming to see the digital forensics in India. Digital forensics in India, it is a 20 years, two decades of long story. In the year 2000-2001, actually it started digital forensics field in India. And at that time, the main laboratories which are performing this services, which are providing this sort of services are AP Forensic Science Laboratory and Central Forensic Science Laboratory at Hyderabad. Of course, the GEQD at that particular point of time. So these are the two laboratories which are providing this sort of services during that particular point of time. And it is almost two decades. And in the recent past, we are seeing a maturity in this particular field with a lot of developments from the government side, as well as the private participants also. To be precise, just a minute, sir, there is some issue with my microphone.
Sir, the slide is also not moving. If you have changed,
pardon, sir.
Sir, have you changed the slide?
Just a minute, sir. I'm just checking that particular thing. Only.
I think now I'm able to clear. Okay, sir.
Yes, sir. Now it's coming.
Okay, fine. So, to understand the trend in the digital forensics as far as India is concerned, we will see the history when it's actually started and how it has moved forward. And futuristic trends, and with a view of the current. So digital forensics, as everybody is having an idea, it is a synthesis of various fields like computer science, law, information technology, which is applied for the collection and analysis of the data from various digital systems, like involving computer systems, normal, that is isolated computer systems, desktop systems, networks, wireless communication devices, and various other storage devices. And this is presented in an admissible format before the judiciary. So this is the discipline that is digital forensics. So in short, if you see, digital forensics is a branch of forensics science encompassing the recovery and investigation of material found in digital devices. So often it is called as computer crime also. And coming to the electronic evidence or digital evidence, what is electronic evidence or digital evidence? Digital evidence is any form of probative value that is either stored or transmitted in a binary form that is called as electronic evidence or digital evidence, which is dealt in the Information Technology Act amended Section 79A, and which is having the characteristics, basic characteristics, that is for invisibility, dynamic nature, volatility, and highly present. So this digital evidence is acts in twofold. One is it provides leads to other evidences and corroborates other evidences. And mostly in simple manner, if you see, it is mostly treated as a secondary evidence as far as the Information Technology Act or Indian Penal Code is concerned. That's why a lot of ambiguity is there around this particular evidence. Whenever the admissibility factor is coming, So I am not much going into the legal aspects of this particular course because the legal experts are the better persons to talk about all these things. But otherwise, a lot of ambiguity and a lot of confusion is building, which is not to be around this particular evidence when it is produced before a judiciary. So if you see the history of digital evidence, it is divided into four categories. Infancy state, that is the 85 to 95 decade. Childhood state, that is the 95 to 2005 decade. Adolescence, 2005 to 2010. And matured, that is the 2010 to current day scenario. So these are the four stages or developments or growth of the digital forensics, which will depict the growth of digital forensics. Coming to the first decade, that is the first, that is infancy, that is the 1980s. Actually, in 1984, all of this particular thing started. That is, the FBI has created magnetic media program, which has become later into computer analysis and response in court. And then during that particular point of time, the tools available to the community are Norton utilities and the analyze tool, which is basically used to recover the deleted data, and then the PC tools for troubleshooting purposes or other purposes. And the primary users for this particular field or practice are financial investigators. Their main aim is to discover all the records. How do you get into all these records into court? That is how they can present these records into court. How the arguments can be placed. All these things are the main purposes. And later on, Association of Certified Fraud Examiners have been developed. So that is the groups. And they began seeking the training in this particular field, which became to computer forensics. The first computer forensics training course was appeared around 1989 at the University of North Texas for this particular group of the people only. And coming to the next decade, that is 1990s, in 1993, first international conference on computer evidence was held. And during this particular conference only, the emphasis with respect to digital evidence and its validation and its importance in the proceedings, legal proceedings, all these have been discussed, and it has stressed the importance of the investigating officers to get trained in this particular field, how to search, how to seize the evidence, and how to preserve the collected evidence, because this is a special type of evidence, and due to its characteristic features, how to handle that particular evidence, all these things have been discussed. And in 1995, IOCE, that is International Organization on Computer Evidence, has been formed, which has framed the guidelines. We have to remember, not standard operating procedures, but guidelines are best practices in forensic examination of digital technology have been framed. By 1997, the G8 countries declared in Moscow, the law enforcement personnel must be trained and equipped to address high-tech crimes. This is the first firm action from the government side at an apex level to identify the importance of this particular field and to stress the skill development in the investigating agencies. And then in 98, this G8 itself appointed IACE to create international principles for the procedures relating to digital evidence. And during the same year, Interpol also has started a symposium, forensic science symposium, and it up the digital forensics or digital also evidence related issues also appeared during this particular symposium. And then coming to the next other activities, the high-tech crime training has been created in South California, that is HTCIA, with 12 members, and it has grown a lot. And then it has now transformed or merged into IACIS. During the same year, expert witness, a commercial tool to support this particular practices, and the community has been released into the market. And ISCIS, of course, till today also, ISCIS is the best treated as one of the best internationally acclaimed training institute in the field of digital forensics. And then another institution, that is the National White Collar Crime Center, NW3C, also has been created with members like FBI, CERT, US, NIJ, and Carnegie Mellon University, all these people. And they formed computer forensic training, that is, course development has been performed. And the other commercial tools released are SafeBack, NKS is also released, Smart by ASR data, FTK by Access data. These are the four commercial tools released into the market. Out of these four tools, NKS and FTK are now still existing, but they are struggling hard to be in the for their footprint in the market because of the new people entering into the market. And then coming to the other developments in 2000, that is in the 2000 year, the first FBI Regional Computer Forensic Science Laboratory has been created or established. And computer forensics has been transformed into cyber forensics because of the networking of the computers. And then NKS has been matured and it released an enterprise version to support investigations over a corporate environment or an organizational environment. Case law also has begun to develop. That is, the various countries have come out with the Information Technology Act. Of course, India also has come out with the IT Act 2000. Later, it was modified in 2008. Computer forensics have emerged from a cottage industry into a unique profession. Universities started giving certifications, tool development, verification projects. All these have been came into picture. And NIST also created a project that is called as the CFTT, Computer Forensic Tool Testing Project, under which various capabilities and, if you say, in simple words, pros and cons are ups and downs of various commercial tools, and some open source tools have been tested, and they have released a booklet into the market with respect to the capabilities of these particular tools. And the project is still live, and various editions are being done to this particular project. And open source community, because the commercial tools are ruling the market and they are charging hefty of prices, open source communities became active, and they thought we have to develop some free and open source tools to support this particular community. So a large number of open source tools and free tools have been entered into the market, into the field, to support the communities. And then Internet Engineering Task Force have come up with a request for comment, that is the guidelines 3227, that is guidelines for evidence collection and archiving, which are being vetted out and followed by various organizations and the communities across the globe. And by 2010, the open source communities have been matured, and now we are seeing a large number of open source tools. Of course, a specific purpose also, they are for a specific purpose or a specific work, open source and free tools are available. Apart from that thing, toolkit sort of thing, that means a mixture of tools to support various aspects of digital forensics are also available, like autopsy, sleuthkit, digital forensic framework, and then other open source platforms are the operating systems like Kane, Swift Workstation, and then the Deft, so many, that is Kali Linux. These are various open source operating systems which evolved to support these particular communities. And now the Scientific Working Group on Digital Evidence, popularly known as SWGDE, which is currently active in developing various quality documents and standard documents related to the best practices in this particular field. And this is very, very good group. and currently active group. All the previous groups have been merged into this particular group, and they are working together to produce the quality manuals and the various standard or guidelines related to this. So this is a pictorial view of all these particular timeline activities. And then coming to the guiding principles of digital forensics, any forensic field is guided by two principles. One is low-cost principle of exchange. The second thing is debtor's rule. Low-cost principle of exchange tells that if any activity has occurred, then there will be an exchange of material or matter. The matter may be visible or invisible between the location and the object, which are objects which are part of the particular location. Objects means they may be live objects, they may be non-live objects. So material or matter is exchanged. So the investigating officer's main aim or the main focus is to collect this particular exchanged material between the scene or between the location and the various materials that are existing at that point of time at that particular location, and to link this particular exchange of material or matter so that the involvement of the particular objects is linked or proved. And then Debbers rule, which is a legal thing and technical point, which tells that regarding the repeatability and reproducibility. So that this is also called as rule of evidence regarding the admissibility of expert witness in the court of law or during the testimony. So repeatability and reproducibility. What is repeatability and reproducibility? Just now we have discussed that there are various commercial tools are available, and there are open source tools are also recently available to the community to perform various tasks of digital forensic analysis, and that can be used during the entire process. That is digital forensic investigation and forensic analysis. So any tool you are using, say for example, one person is having A tool, the other person is having B tool, some other person is having some C tool. Whatever the tool you people are using, ultimately the results should be one and the same. So whatever may be the tool you are using, whatever the path, the second thing is the path you are using, methodology you are using, ultimately the results should be the same, one and the same. That is the repeatability and reproducibility rule tells, that is the Debbers rule. So here one point we have to remember that many people will be asking a question, what are the valid tools or recognized tools or recommended tools to perform the digital forensic task? One point of the community or anybody has to remember is no organization, no government has till today notified these tools are viable tools, or these tools only has to be used during this particular procedure. The only thing is, whatever the tool you are using, they have to satisfy this particular Debbers rules, that is repeatability, reproducibility, and peer review also has to be performed with respect to that particular tools, which the community is going to be using. So this point, at a large number of forums or at various forums, people will be asking the question to various speakers, not only me, that what tool has to be used, whether this particular X tool is recognized or Y tool is recognized. So it is not said that some particular tool is recognized and some other tool is not recognized. Only thing is the NIST program, that is some computer forensic tool testing program, is the basic guide in assessing the pros and cons or ups and downs of a particular tool. So that's why some tools are capable of doing some sort of activities and some tools are able to do some specific type of activities. That's why in the digital forensic community, in the starting days, people are relying on a single tool, something like NCASE, RFPK, something like that. But later on, because when it has been exposed that these two, a particular tool is capable of so and so activities, and the particular tool is capable of so and so other type of capabilities, then the community started testing the digital evidence or analyzing the digital evidence with multi-tool environment. So nowadays, with a single tool, no examination is concluded. The expert or the examiner is using one tool, more than one tool, that is two tools or three tools according to their availability in their particular laboratory. But at least two tools the examiner is using during their day-to-day routine to get the results in a foolproof and near to completion manner. So this is all about regarding the tools. And coming to the guidelines, as I have told previously, there are mostly guidelines are available to support this particular field, and the standard operating procedures or standard operating standards are not precisely telling standards are not available. All the available things are only guidelines. So it all started in the 1990s and consolidation of all the guidelines took place in 2000s. And IOCE, that is International Organization of Computer Evidence, is the first organization to release the best practices in the year 1995. And these are the various titles of the particular guidelines. Guidelines for best practice in the forensic examination of digital technology. Guide good practices for seizing electronic devices. First responders template. These are all the documents. So if anybody is are interested, they can download from that particular list to have how the developed knowledge or idea, how the two guidelines or standards are shaping up during the last 2 decades. This particular group has now transformed to SWGD, which I have been just mentioning, which is currently active in producing the current day standards or the current day guidelines. And then the second most preferred guidelines are from the Association of Chief of Police, a UK organization, popularly known as Act for Principles. These are the very, very popular guidelines. And the current version, if I am not wrong, the version 6 or 7 is currently in the practice. And the other guidelines are CERT training and education, CERT US. This has released two documents in 2005. One I have mentioned in this slide. The other you can have from the same location. The first document is First Responders Guide to Computer Forensics. The second one is Advanced Topics in Digital Forensics or Computer Forensics. These are the two documents, and these two documents form the very, very basic or the under, basic under, for basic understanding of the practices and the procedures followed in this particular field. And to start with, I personally advise any student or any person to get these two documents. Of course, these two documents are free of freely downloadable from the Carnegie Mellon Society US website or portal. These are the two starting documents for anybody who are entering into this particular field to understand various concepts and processes. The next scientific working group on imaging technology, whose main focus is to frame the standard operating procedures or the guidelines to tackle the multimedia related files, that is images and video related files. Of course, this also has now dissolved and it has been converted into SWGDE. And then the other thing is IETF, which I would have already told, released the RFC 3227 document, guidelines for evidence collection and archiving. And then the other guidelines, if you see, NIJ guidelines are there, NIST guidelines are there. Okay, so there are so many guidelines have been there. But as I have told, in the decade 2000, that is later by 2005 mostly, all these guidelines have been dissolved and converged, converged, and uniform guidelines have been came into picture, and SWGD is maintaining that particular documentation. So coming to the standards, ISO IEC standards, ISO 27000 series of standards are mostly related to digital evidence and cyber security related aspects. And among all these things, the 5 documents mostly relevant to digital forensics is 27037, which is released in 2012, 27041 released in 15, 27042 released in 15, 27043 that also released in 2015. All these are related, covering the topics like identifying, gathering, preserving the digital evidence, assurance in e-forensics, analysis, interpretation of this, all these. So by 2016, the ISO has constituted a committee to consolidate all these procedures and to frame another standard, that is 27050, which is supposed to be released in three parts. The first part was released or published. The other two parts are expected to be published actually during the last year itself, but due to Corona and other things, it was delayed, and the community is eagerly awaiting for that particular other two standards to be released by the ISO organization. So all these standards or guidelines, the main aim is to promote good practices and procedures in this particular. Coming to this is entirely international scene. Coming to India, many people will be asking whether there are any standards or guidelines are there which are notified by some competent authority in India. But as on today, in India, various organizations, say for example, Income Tax Department, they are having their own set of procedures. DRI, they are having their own set of procedures. Customs and Central Excise, they are having their own set of standards or guidelines. Each and every state also are having their own set of guidelines and standards. So having multiple sets of guidelines and standards is bringing ambiguity during the trial, and then confusion during the trial, and then for the investigating officers also a lot of confusion. And all these particular standards are not 100%. That means they are not covering all aspects of this particular field and the newly emerging areas also in this particular field. So this is to be noted, and at every forum or at every conference or every dais, this point is being brought to the notice of the competent authorities so that they can take some action to constitute some committee to frame a standard guidelines or standards specific to India. Of course, in the backdrop, the connectivity should be to the international standardization, that is mapping should be to the international standards, but keeping in view the special scenarios like technical scenarios, skill levels, and then the legal provisions in India, the standards have to be framed to suit the Indian scenarios. There should be only one standards should be there, or one guideline should be there, which are to be notified by some competent authority, so that across the country, every organization, whether it is a state government police or a central government organization or a law enforcement agency or any other public sector related organization, all of them have one standard to follow, and it becomes easy during the practicing of this particular practices to be followed in this particular field. And in the legal scenario also, a lot of ambiguity will be removed. So this is my small submission once again before this forum. And coming to the digital forensics in industry, the digital forensics is being used at various by various agencies for various purposes. Coming to the law enforcement agencies, they will be using digital forensics as for evidence collection, evidence analysis, intelligence gathering. Industry, coming to the industry, they will be using it as a security life cycle as part of incident analysis, incident reporting, mitigation, and eradication. Of course, some other aspects are also there. That is what is this called, internal compliance and external compliance to maintain their business activities. Coming to the military or defense, they are using these digital forensics mainly for the purpose of intelligence gathering, and then take necessary steps to overcome this particular overcome certain sort of activities. Coming to the maturity view, digital forensics has a maturity view. Previously, it is a reactive mode. So some incident has been occurred. The investigating agencies will start investigation, and then they will be collecting the digital material or storage material. They will be sending them to the laboratory to perform the analysis related to a particular incident. So this is all reactive mode, that is involving disk imaging, data recovery, log analysis, correlation, malware forensics, e-discovery, incident response management, mobile forensics. All this comes under the reactive mode, that is a post-incident. The other later on it became to proactive, that is the pre-incident. Before the incident is happened, the agencies wants to collect certain amount of data and then analyze that particular data to guess to that so a certain particular incident is going to occur. So accordingly, they can pre-plan the security protocols or security mechanisms to avoid that particular sort of incidents that can happen. So it involves CM, data collection from CM and analysis in real time, malware analysis, software forensics, database forensics, embedded system forensics. As part of the SCADA security. And then the other thing is predictive forensics. Predictive forensics is having a combination of data from the proactive and reactive mode. And by using the big data concept and data analytics techniques, and then the uses of latest technologies like machine learning and artificial intelligence, the investigating agencies across the globe are trying to have a pre-incident scenario, and then they are going to predict that a particular activity at a particular location is going to initiate another activity at another location, something like that, and then they are taking necessary actions to curb that particular incident to happen. So this is called a predictive type of forensics. So in all these things, the digital forensics is playing a major role. And then coming to the digital forensic process, I think everybody are having the idea of all these procedures. Of course, there are four digital forensic models are there. Coming to that particular models, I think this is not the correct platform or the thing to discuss. But these steps are derived by inculcating all the particular forensic models, that is four existing models. And this involves identification, collection, preservation, validation, authentication, analysis, and then interpretation, documentation, and presentation. This is people will be telling only four steps or five steps, but I have put it all those particular four steps in a detailed manner. So that's why we are having some eight steps here. And then the main aim of this particular procedures, follow these procedures, is to reconstruct the events found to be criminal. So coming to the golden rules of digital forensics, these are the five rules, that is never mishandle the evidence, never work on the original evidence, never trust the subject operating system, use proper software utilities, document everything. These are basically the five guidelines or the five cardinal rules of digital forensics. Of course, these five rules are also being changed in the latest developments. Out of all these tools, the one which is drastically affected is never work on original evidence. This particular piece of rule is drastically changed, and across the globe, people are nowadays used to work on the original evidence directly. Of course, in India, still it is not a practice, but across the globe, already people are moving towards working on original evidence directly with the forensic tools or techniques. So this thing is nowadays a big question mark as far as there is validity and authenticity of the evidence after the analysis is being concluded. So my personal opinion is this sort of working on original evidence may be acceptable in some sort of scenarios, but in a legal scenario, this practice is not a viable one or a good one, because in a legal scenario, we have to address various questions like who has done it, how he has done it, why he has done it, what tools he has used, when it has been performed. So many things we have to address. So that's why my personal opinion is not to follow this particular rule in the changed manner. So the original, we can share that particular thing. And then coming to the branches of digital forensics. These are the various branches of digital evidence, digital forensics, but these branches are also now growing into inorganically and organically into various new branches like malware forensics, IoT forensics, drone forensics, cloud forensics, crypto forensics. So many and specialized fields are coming into this particular field, that is digital forensics. Embedded system forensics is also another thing. So basically these are the 5 or 6 branches, but if you see in total nowadays, specialization is the need of the hour, keeping in view the drastic growth in the technology and various peripherals, digital peripherals that are flooding into the market. So coming to the storage history, if you see the storage history starting from punch card tapes to the latest cloud and IoT sensors, all these things, these are providing the digital evidence stored within that particular device. And coming to the digital security lifecycle, in a digital security lifecycle, digital forensics is the balancing needle in the entire process. If you see that, it is in the middle, that is in the analysis, that is digital forensics is in the middle portion. Incident has happened and they have collected some sort of evidential material, investigation has started, the collected evidence has been sent for analysis, that is there wherein the digital forensics will be coming. And then basing on the results, containment and resilience will be taken care and deterrence also will be taken care. So it is a continuous process. And this is the present and futuristic approach already we have discussed with the respect to this thing. And coming to the challenges, current day the digital forensics is facing is, there are 4 challenges are there. One is administrative challenge, the second thing is legal challenge, the third one is human resource challenge, and the fourth one is a technical challenge. And if you discuss all these things one by one, coming to the administrative challenge. The administrative challenge being, what are the procedures to establish a digital forensic laboratory? How the digital forensic laboratory has to be established? What is the blueprint of the particular laboratory? Which sort of equipment the laboratory has to have? And which sort of tools and how many number of tools the laboratory should have? And then what are the quality procedures to be followed? Because nowadays, any laboratory has to get the notification by the IT, under the IT Act. And then there are other quality standards are related to ISO, IEC standards, and then the NABL standards, all these things. How to maintain the particular standards, how to get the human skilled human resources, and how to enhance the skill level of the existing and newly entering staff into this particular field by recurring training programs. And then legal challenges like 65B is one legal challenge. The evidence is treated as secondary evidence more in the jury, before the judiciary, and that how it has to be dealt with. And there are so much of ambiguity, legal ambiguity is there in the admissibility of this digital evidence. So Supreme Court judgments itself are having, at one point of time, they are telling secondary evidence, no problem. In some point of time, secondary evidence, primary, the presence of primary evidence is a must. That sort of judgment is also there. So there is ambiguity, and the ambiguity is building up, increasing. Why? Because coming into the new entrants like crowd forensics, Internet of Things forensics, and so during this particular thing, getting the primary evidence presented before the judiciary is the biggest challenge, because in a cloud forensics, people will be getting or downloading the data from a remote server. In IoT also, the data is being obtained from various locations like cloud artifacts, various sensors, various networking devices, all these things. And then the evidence is being analyzed and presented before the court. So the getting the primary evidence, bringing before the judiciary, is the biggest challenge. Similarly, in the drone forensics also, the primary evidence, getting the primary evidence, that is from the servers or the cloud resources, that is also the biggest challenge. So these are various legal challenges are there. I am putting only few. There are so many other legal challenges are there. getting the emails analyzed from a email server which is located outside the country, and in some cases getting the data from the service providers Google or Microsoft or any other social media platforms, and then that particular results presenting as an evidence before the judiciary. So in all these cases, the primary evidence is something lying somewhere, and through some particular technical and administrative arrangement, the data has been downloaded and analyzed and presented as an evidence. So how to prove that particular the veracity and authenticity and of this particular case? There is a lot of ambiguity is there legally. And coming to the technical aspects, technical challenges. Coming to technical challenges, there are various technical challenges are there. And my main focus in the next slides will be these particular technical challenges only. The other challenge, that is human resource challenges. If you see the human resource challenge, most of the forensic science laboratories in the country, they are not having the people recruited for this particular purpose. Already working people have been given some sort of training or skill development, and they are being indulged into this particular practice. So it is one of the to maintain the skill level of the particular human resource to suit the current day developments in the field, and to address the challenges in this particular field is the biggest point or the challenge. So now we can see further the technical challenges. These are the various technical challenges or technical trends that have been observed in the recent past. That is, the volume of the data is being enormous in the nowadays. If you see one hard disk, and on average, the size of the hard disk is 2 terabyte, and analyzing the data in that particular 2 terabyte, that is the biggest challenge. That is precisely analyzing. The most common question that is being asked by the people is, please provide all the deleted and active data. So this is the most common question in 90% of the scenarios that is being coming across. But the questions are should be precise, so that the reports also should be precise and quality. Because of this simple question like provide all the active and inactive or deleted data, that is having a lot of challenges. Because legal challenge, coming to the first challenge, legal challenge, because of the data privacy or personal data protection issues, when the disk is they may be containing a vital evidence material, and apart from that, a lot of personal information also. When the investigating officer is asking for to provide the completed data, active and deleted, it will be containing all this particular thing. That is evidentially important data, and then the personal and so many other active. So there will be a challenge how this personal data has to be, the privacy of this particular data, privacy to be protected of that particular individual. Of course, he is a accused person or whatever may be, but it will be a big challenge when we are providing the entire data. So tomorrow, if any defense counsel is posing this question, it will be a very, very challenging situation for the investigating officer as well as the laboratory people also. So the investigating officers has to evolve from this sort of questions, and they have to put a proper questionnaire, precise questionnaire, so that analysis also will become easy, and that is the focus of analysis can become lucid, and it become easy to report the particular evidential material in a proper and qualitative manner. Encryption is the second challenge or trend. Nowadays, BitLocker encryption and then other various varieties of encryptions are being offered by the third-party utilities or inbuilt utilities. So implementation of this particular encryption technologies is one of the biggest challenges, like BitLocker, Lux, and then the TCP encryption, Sophos encryption, Microsoft endpoint encryptions, so many things. And then if any encrypted material or encrypted data is being received or to be analyzed by way of decryption. If at all any supportive material like some sort of keys are available, then only it becomes easy for the laboratory people to analyze that particular sort of data. So the investigating officers have to be thorough enough with this sort of scenarios at the scene of crime while seizing. They have to verify the materials or the existence of any sort of encryptions or otherwise. Then if any such sort of scenario is there, then they have to collect the keys from the proper authority, like the administrator or the accused person, something like that. And if at all those particular credentials are being provided, that it becomes the decryption of the particular data will become easy and it will be facilitated. Device diversity. Device diversity, nowadays we are seeing a large number of devices, wide variety of devices, starting from the ways old floppy, of course floppy disks are not there, but normal disks, to the latest digital sensors used in IoT devices. So a large number of digital devices are existing, and in certain cases like IoT devices or cloud or drone, how to collect the data and how to preserve the data and how to analyze that particular data is the biggest. Still today, no proper technical standards or guidelines are present to address these particular scenarios. So it is only case-to-case basis we have to frame certain sort of procedures which are forensically sound, and then we have to conduct the analysis and provide the evidence reports. So this is another challenge. Technography is another challenge, that is hiding something in any other container, any other things. So that is the technography. And then use of anti-forensic tools like wiping tools, erasers, or otherwise existence of specialized system on chips, firmware chips also is the biggest challenge. Secure operating systems like Tails is one of the secure operating systems. There are so many other secure operating systems are available. How to deal with these particular things? These secure operating systems are not necessarily be installed. They can be executed through external media or through in a cloud environment also, like using Amazon web services or Azure, something like that. So how to trace back all these particular secure operating system related artifacts, and how to identify the relevant artifacts which are useful for the purpose of investigation and presentation before the legal. That is another. Custom built operating systems mostly we are finding in DVRs, digital video recorders, or NVRs. And these DVR systems or NVR systems, they use their own specialized file systems and operating systems. And when the disks are being tried to forensically analyze, then it is the biggest challenge for the community today. Of course, there are only few tools are available, one or two good tools, that's two commercial tools. And the procedures to tackle the sort of scenarios are still to be not evolved or matured. So this is another challenge. Virtualization. Coming to the virtualization, there are two scenarios are there: local virtualization and the remote virtualization. Local virtualization is something like VMware machines presence, and how to extract the data from the VMware machines, particularly which are encrypted. That is the biggest challenge. Coming to the remote virtualization, that is something like a cloud phenomena or something like an Azure type of thing, or Amazon Web Services, or Dropbox, or Google Drive. All these things come under the remote virtualization scenario. Under this particular remote virtualization, the biggest challenge is the file metadata, preservation of the file metadata, and how to tackle that issue. So in the case of elastic clouds, the biggest challenge is how to get the deleted content, because in the elastic services, the cloud services, as you are putting the data, because of the name, from the name Elastic, the drive size is increasing. when you delete the data automatically, the drive size is diminished. That means the deleted data is lost. Only the live data is present. This is another challenge with respect to the virtualization. Malware forensics. Coming to the malware forensics, this is the most discussed area in the current day cybersecurity scenario because of the zero-day attacks and so many ransomware attacks. After the corona effect, the increase in this particular aspect is very, very high. And how to tackle all these things also the biggest challenge with respect to malware forensics. Source code forensics. Source code forensics is related to the intellectual property rights related challenge. So up till because of the automation, programs or the codes are being built with the pre-configured modules. So when you compare two programs or two codes, there may be chances that approximately 90% or more than 90% match may be there. So how to prove that a particular source code or a code is a proprietary? So for that thing, we have to use some specialized techniques like fuzzy hash matching techniques and so many other techniques like identifying the proprietary content and some sort of specific codes allocated to the specific tag numbers allotted to the particular modules of the in the modules of the code. So those type of analysis are the required practices to overcome this particular sort of trends or challenges. Cloud forensics, already we have discussed regarding the cloud. IoT also. Embedded system forensics, because of the evolvement of the IoT devices, we are having various types of small chip-based instruments which are storing some sort of data related to a particular activity. So how to tackle these particular chips, the only way is to chip off. That means unsolder the chips and place them in a suitable adapter and get the data dumped and then perform the analysis. So the standards are not evolved. They are very, very fluid. And so this is the challenge with respect to embedded system forensics. And then blockchain, I have told crypto forensics or blockchain forensics. This is altogether a different topic and a lot of discussion is being going on with respect to this particular sort of technology. Of course, this technology is a foolproof technology that can be utilized or implemented at various in various fields of activities. But coming to the primary one, that is the financial one, that is cryptocurrencies. With respect to cryptocurrencies, how the fraudulent transactions have to be identified, how to mark them, and then how to pinpoint it, say that this transaction is from so-and-so location and so-and-so person has done this particular sort of transaction. All these things are the biggest challenge. So these are the various technical challenges in this fiscal forest. So these are the various elaborated slides for all these technical challenges and how to overcome that particular technical challenge. The first one is volume of the data. That means we are searching for the needle in a haystack of needles. So the methodologies that can be used is strengthening the triage process, use of KFF or denesting, dual data analysis, multi-analysis approach, use of automation, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. Concept of digital forensics as a service is growing slowly, and it is still to be matured. And then dual data analysis, that means at the same point of time, the laboratory people and the IO, both are professional investigator. I am not telling the normal IOs. Professionally trained investigator can perform the analysis to complete the task within a limited period of time. This is multi-analyst report. The image, digital forensic image, will be analyzed by various analysts for various purposes. That is various challenges. Like one will be analyzing with respect to image analysis, that is multimedia content. One will be analyzing email related analysis. The other person will be analyzing the office documents, something like that. So that the analysis task can be concluded in a limited period of time. And then encryption. So the coming to the encryption, these are the various challenges, A1 chip, T2 chip, all these things. So use of high performance computing, distributed analysis framework and digital forensics as a service might be the solutions to overcome this sort of challenges. And in the case of mobile and chip, embedded system forensics has to be utilized. And this is the digital device diversity. And future, my expectation is embedded system forensics will be the most of the solution. And then steganography, the solution is EXE and DLL file analysis, registry analysis, volume shadow copy, restore point analysis, super timeline analysis. These are the some of the methodologies that can be adopted to overcome this particular challenge. Coming to anti-forensics, super timeline analysis, registry analysis, executable and DLL file analysis, volume shadow copy and restore point analysis. These are some of the way outs to tackle this particular challenge. Secure operating systems, I am also not having any idea how to deal with the secure operating systems. So ideas are invited for dealing with the startup scenarios. Because they cannot they are not being installed in some sort of location, they can be taken from expandable or external storage devices or some sort of a cloud scenarios. So how to tackle these things is the biggest thing. Custom built operating systems, for this thing a research methodology has to be adopted. Documentation of the file systems, so that is the unpopular or closed file systems. Use of data carving techniques also will be a way out to deal these sort of scenarios. Virtualization, coming to the virtualization, local virtualization can be dealt. Of course, if it is, there is any encrypted local containers are there, then that is a challenge. But otherwise, in a normal course, it may not be a challenge. Coming to the global virtualization, the challenges already we have discussed, that is with respect to the metadata authentication, and then the elastic related clouds, that is getting the deleted data. And then presenting this particular thing in a proper fashion before the judiciary, because the primary evidence is not there here, only secondary evidence is present here. And then, so these are all the cloud trends. In the cloud trends, this slide is mostly important as far as my idea is concerned, because in the cloud, various actors will be there, like cloud carrier, cloud consumer, cloud auditor, cloud provider, cloud broker, and cloud provider, they are having various architectures like service layers like SaaS, PaaS, IaaS, so many things, and then public cloud, private cloud, hybrid cloud, so many things are there. So out of all these players or actors, the cloud auditor's place is the vital place for a forensic scientist or forensic practitioner also, because cloud auditor will be having administrative rights to overview or to scrutinize all other actors. So the cloud auditor, actually the scope of the cloud auditor is these three activities. That is a security audit, performing the security audit, privacy impact audit, and performance audit. These three audits he will be performing. He is not at all concerned about all other activities. But as a forensic examiner, by sitting as in the as a director of cloud auditor, we will be having a space to perform forensic activities. That is data collection, reservation, analysis, all these things can be performed. So my view is forensic person or forensic individual, cyber digital forensic individual, will be having a criteria of cloud auditor also in the investigations or forensics related to cloud forensics. So these are various things. So IoT, in the IoT, it is the convergence, as I have already told, wireless technologies, micro electrochemical systems, microservices, the internet, cloud, big data analytics, all these are the converged into to form the IoTs. So in the IoTs, the data is spread across all these things, over the network, over the data center, over the various sensor devices, all these things. So the data has to be collected from various resources, and that has to be combined together to form the complete analysis aspect. So the challenges are data diffusion, chain of custody, tool applicability, high change rate, cloud interaction. These are the various challenges. So we have to collect data from volatile devices, non-volatile devices, network devices, cloud devices, and then embedded devices. So all from all these various locations, data has to be collected. And please remember, the challenge is where is the primary evidence when it comes to the judiciary. So this is the biggest challenge. So these are the various IoT forensics related challenges and the various entities that has to be dealt as part of the IoT forensics for investigation. So blockchain trends, coming to the blockchain trends, these are the characteristics of blockchain, that is decentralized, always availability, openness, permissionless, durability, robustness, SHA-256 hash function, public key cryptography. These are the various characteristics. And then the associated fields where this particular blockchain concepts can be used. So this is all about the digital forensic trends. You can see in the current day and in future, near future. Thank you.